Here, if I mumble, interrupt me and let me know it. Thank you all for coming. I'm a mad doctor. I've been called that over the years. Alienists, medical psychologists, and other less complimentary terms. We need to talk about the 19th century lunatic asylum. And I'm going to sort of compare and contrast with what came before and what came after. You can't know what you're doing without the history and what it meant. Although there's a recreated asylum in colonial Williamsburg, there is no smiling actor handing out laudanum samples. Although arguably it would be a much more popular event were that done. I'll use the terms of the time. Lunacy, madness, insanity, idiocy, imbecility. The terms current now are regarded as degrading, insulting, dehumanizing, and they are. But although we have tidied up our language in the intervening centuries, our cultural attitude is still shaped by these words. While the literature of the time has plentiful exposés of the abuses suffered by people in asylum settings, but that wasn't what the asylums were for. That wasn't why they were developed, why they were made. They were intended as a humane alternative to the abuses of a previous era. Inhumanity towards the insane predated the lunatic asylum era and persists after it. Arguably, they were better than what had been before. What was before? Well, there was family care, okay? Locked up or boarded up in an attic, locked in a cellar, considered case of poor Mrs. Rochester, confined in the attic for a decade after her mind broke. Her beauty was ruined, and she was dead by suicide while her husband carried on an affair with the hired governess for the mistress's child, for goodness sake. Well, where's the justice in that? Okay, well, if not your loving family, where? There was a private trade in madness. These were elite situations. Edgar Allan Poe's The System of Dr. Tarr and Professor Feather talks about just such a privately run asylum. It was in the direct economic interest of the keeper to keep the kept there and of the moneyed family to keep their embarrassing relative off somewhere else. The more dramatic attempts at cure by bleeding, purgatives, depletion, blistering, those took place in such settings. There were legacy institutions. Okay, this is the Bethlehem Royal Hospital. This is Bedlam. It was originally a priory in London that took in the sick and the indigent. In 1403, it had six madmen, six iron chains, two pairs of stocks, four sets of manacles. In Paris, you had the Bicêtre and Saint-Pétrier. Any francophones, please help me with this. There was a very interesting situation in Lille, Belgium. Anyone's ever seen the movie The King of Hearts? Alan Bates and Genevieve Rougeau.
Yes.
Alan Bates, you do see his stories. Genevieve Bougeot does keep her tutu on the entire thing. It's a lovely movie. At the end of it, though, it centers around the asylum gates in Gier, Belgium. So it grew up around the shrine of Saint Dimphna. If you know your saints, you'll know she's the patron saint of the mentally ill. In 1851, about 1,000 souls lived in this little town in Belgium, about one patient to every 10 residents. they were housed in the community. They were housed in garrets, lofts, outhouses, other sort of out-of-the-way nooks and crannies. They were generally decently clothed and well-fed. There was no treatment program as such, although field work was common among the alongside the farmers in the town. They did use physical restraints, iron fetters, which caused ulcers, were used. Only the calm and unthreatening would live with the townsfolk. The best behaved ones in the town is less so out to the more rural areas. There was also a traditional asylum for the suicidal and violent. This is probably where family care comes from, a model that is still in use today. Well, then there was the county or parish almshouses and poorhouses. Okay, many can't go there, and they would rather die. They would rather die, since usually better do it and decrease the surplus population. All right, the poorhouse. This was a mixed bag of inebriates, prostitutes, vagrants, transients, and vagabonds. The mentally ill were a vulnerable population, were abused and exploited and attacked in these. And there was a hodgepodge of local jails and prisons, generally shackled to a wall, locked in a basement or a cattle stall. When the mad proved troublesome, they could expect to be beaten, jailed, or left to roam and rot. From the 1830s to the American Civil War, the treatment of the insane was a central topic in the cultural conversation about democracy, freedom, and modernity. There was a great utopian movement to rehabilitate the mad. It was the duty of society to repair the minds that had been broken by modernity, and the effort was funded by the entire polity through the tax levies, no longer just by private charity or religious charity, as in the legacy institutions of Bethlehem. Hundreds of these were built. In the US, 300 asylums, public asylums, were built before 1900. By 1890, there was one asylum bed for every 750 Americans, 133 per 100,000. Yeah, some people argue that maybe a 1-to-1 ratio might have been more appropriate for the American But now, introduce a lunatic asylum as the second story, and you're set for a horror story. Okay, this is, of course, Arkham Asylum. There was an extensive popular literature, by the way, about asylums at the time. The Victorians loved a good freak show, and they wouldn't pass up such an opportunity to fill a penny dreadful with the tyrannical asylum keeper, the state madman, the imperiled innocent, or terrifying treatment. By the way, here's the Batman, there's Mr. J, Leavale, Arkham Asylum. Take a look at this tower here, and this tower here. This is Arkham Asylum. Take a look at the towers of this period. This is in Buffalo. So, what we know now is definitively that Arkham Asylum, where the Batman puts the Joker, the Riddler, Poison Ivy, Harley Quinn, was actually in Buffalo. Okay, you can see the evidence. It's really, it's that tower, right? The masonry hulks of these asylums still dot the landscape, and their myth still infuses the literature, the landscape of fiction. Well, why are they Gothic? Well, for the Victorians, Gothic architecture was elevating, uplifting, and inspiring. It was beautiful. For moderns, it's the proper setting for horror, How many ghosts haunt split level ranches? Apparently being dead gives you better taste in architecture. Okay, how did this come to be? Why do we associate a Gothic architecture with mental illness? There is a huge stigma against mental illness, against association with the mad, that spreads. There's to anybody who is involved with them. Family members, the medical specialty that treats them, that branch of the legal profession that represents their rights when hospitalized under involuntary care. Insanity, the loss of one's mind, is deeply and very existentially frightening, both for the sufferer and for the observer alike. If you associate with the mad in any way, a bit of their stigma will rub off on you, including the buildings. Okay. Well, the past is a foreign country, they do things differently there. For the medieval mind, the causation of mental illness was spiritual. It was a spiritual malady. It was possession, by a foreign, malignant, demonic spiritual entity. The cure was to persuade the demon to leave or to force it out by scourging the vessel, exorcism. If the patient died, they died in a state of grace. Look, life during the Middle Ages was pretty brutal, short, nasty. If you died, better to have it done and over with. Go to your final reward. 19th century causation, though, people started thinking differently about it. Madness for the 19th century mind was multifactorial. It was an interaction between constitutional factors, inherited factors, and factors of the environment. Okay, here we have kicked in the head by a horse. That can't have been good for you. Hereditary predisposition, ill treatment by husband. Okay. Bad whiskey. That's right. Tobacco and masturbation. Overstudy of religion. Overtaxing of mental hours. Novel reading. Folks, library,
library. Sections over there.
Deranged masturbation, death of sons in war, okay, you see that, there's a story there. Suppressed masturbation, egotism, dissolute habits, here we go, sexual abuse and stimulants, vicious vices, Salvation Army, exposure to quackery, exposure to hereditary, excessive sexual abuse, okay, can't have a good, proper amount of sexual abuse, okay. Anyway, parents were cousins, this is the Trans-Allegheny take aside of after all. Hereditary weakness, prolonged intense application, overindulgence in just about anything, lack of balance, too much study, too much religion. Civilization itself was provocative of insanity. For women, the disturbances tended to be physical fluxes of change of life, childbirth, nursing, puberty, menopause, tight lacing of corsets, mistreatment, death of loved ones. Sexual indulgence, onanism particularly, was both a cause and a symptom of madness. This has an idea that you had just a certain amount of energy, and if you expended it, well, there were various ways to expend it. Okay. For men, insanity tended to be confrontation with the competitive aspects of 19th century capitalism. did cause a dysregulation or loss of self-control. They were onto something there. The term asylum begs the question, asylum from what? This was a time of extremely rapid technological change, driving extremely rapid social change. Madness resulted from the stresses of a rapidly industrializing economy. There was a breakdown of traditional occupations, traditional roles, disruption of the old agrarian feudal order, rise of the capitalist and bourgeois classes, which hadn't really existed much before. There was intellectual and religious freedom, with both the excesses and the anxieties provoked by that. There was a rise in social disruption, a disruption of family ties, a disruption of a close-knit village community, a breakdown of traditional religion of the time, and a destruction of traditional family structures for care of the man. There's a rise of the service economy. You could pay somebody to look after uncle. You had to pay to get somebody else to look after auntie because you had to go work in the mills. Caregiving is time consuming. There's a rise in wage labor. Urbanization itself was considered to be toxic because of impure air. It was very important given the miasma theory of contagion at the time. Overcrowding, degenerate population, and competitive overstimulation. We tend to base our model, how the mind works, on the highest technology of our era. For Descartes, of the Renaissance, the highest technology was clockwork. So he had a notion of dualism, a sort of clockwork mind, a soul that had nothing to do with the physical mechanisms itself. The 21st century, our highest technology is
computers.
We tend to talk then of mental functions sort of like computers, which it's not. Post-modernity, maybe we'll talk in terms of mental models more like the weather or an ecosystem. Actually, probably more reflective of the way the brain actually does function. And in the 19th century, the pinnacle of technology was steam. Well, productive in steam with pressure building up somewhere, channeled to release somewhere else. You could release it productively. Okay. There we go. To do good business work, make money. Go. This is steam being productively used. Beautiful engines. This is like the Canandaigua facility for a wonderful festival. And we have then unproductive release of steam energy. Or unproductive release of steam energy through, say, onanism. And this is the natural fate of a steam engine set to a task for which it is not equal. Everybody at the time knew of this. If you took a mind that was too weak for the academic charges it had, or not up to the business tasks at hand, this was the natural consequence of what you would say. Now, who were the asylums? Well, they were not only distressed, but they were distressing to others. The insane relative threatened the smooth day-to-day operation of the family. Nexus, the Victorian era, worshipped the family life. The majority of people in insane asylums would, by today's standards, also be considered to have mental illnesses. Major depression, bipolar disorder, the peripheral psychoses. The women's unit were very more than appropriate. Okay. the natural course of the affective disorders of the peripheral places is to get better. There was a pretty high discharge rate. A lot of people also had schizophrenia, which is called chronic. Severe anxiety disorders, like obsessive compulsive disorder, very disabling, also quite rare. It was in the interest of the asylum and the asylum superintendent to demonstrate that we could cure people. These were public institutions. So when the asylum gates closed behind you, they did not necessarily close forever. About 40 to 60% were released within a year of admission. At the Royal Crichton Asylum, they'll have about half remained for life. Okay. Here we have, the rest were a mixed bag. People with syphilis, generalized paralysis of the insane, people who were deprived of their wits by old age, traumatic brain injuries and other organic mental disorders, epilepsy, being a weakness of the nervous system, was considered appropriate for asylum care. People who are sexually deviant, particularly transgender, for example, our own Joseph Lobdell, born Lucy Lobdell, 1829 to 1912, lived at the Willard Insane Asylum, 1879 to 1912. If you are religiously inconvenient, for example, a Mormon, an atheist, or Mrs. Packard. She was an interesting lady. She was the wife of a Congregationalist minister and started to develop certain notions about the role of Virgin Mary in itself that did not sit well with her husband. But when she proposed converting to Methodism, that tore it. So he got a couple of physicians who were members of his prayer meeting, gardening, playing the flute. Here we have Richard Dodd, originally combined with Bethlehem, and later born or asylum after he killed his father. He was at work on, I think it's the Fairy Feathers Master Stroke. He also painted Oberon and Titania. There were dances, lunatic balls, lunatic dances at the Coney Hatch. These were a thing. Another lunatic dance. Lecture series, debates. This is the Opal, which was written and published by the patients at Utica, Upstate Asylum. Okay. This is ASM. He's the editor of the Opal. He was a physician. Lived out his life at the asylum. He published the Opal. Sometimes he ate his own feces. Here we have him, Harper's Magazine. They would cut his, he commissioned it by from another patient there. Golf. Golf was considered particularly soothing for the mind. Happy Jack Chesbrough and the Dominican Asylums. Okay. 1892, the team went undefeated except for two narrow losses to the New York Giants. For the ladies, there was a lawn tennis, croquet, lawn bowling. Asylums had libraries and librarians. Generally, the librarian would be a patient there. Indoor recreations, okay, billiards, chess, card, checkers. There was reading newspapers, magazines, morally improving literature, natural sciences, light fiction, moral tales, history, religion of the right sort. Okay. The asylum chaplain would prescribe bits of scripture, elevated bits for the morose, calming and soothing bits for the overexcited. You'd no more give an entire Bible to a patient than you'd give a patient the keys to the apothecary. Okay. Overdoses of Ezekiel, overdoses of Matthew 5:29-30, Mark 9:43-48, those are notoriously toxic. Those were not good signs. This is the chapel at Greystone. in New Jersey. Good food, large amounts, bland, moderate exercise, walks in brisk air. Mr. Samuel Tuke at the York Retreat in England, a Quaker, noted the tendency in himself to become drowsy after substantial meals of beef with cheese and pork. So he prescribed it to his more excitable patients. There was an emphasis on ensuring ample starch and fat in order to avoid overexcitement. Plenty of sleep, absence of too much intensity, a regular schedule, regular visits from the superintendent, or the matron, the superintendent's wife, generally, the woman, schedule would be tightly regulated. Patients would spend most of the days actually in the parlors or day rooms of the asylums. Then he has that one. Notice the caged birds and the busts of various Greek people. Productive work. Okay. Oh, here's Broadmoor Asylum, the day room. Looks very much like a gentleman's club. Here's Richard Dodd. You might notice the sort of double bar series on the windows here. This was a criminal asylum. Everybody there and killed somebody. Okay, yes, productive work was very important. So when Sabina Spielreins was raving in the duck pond, the staff called Professor Bueller, who comes and sees this scene. And his reaction is, I shall have Dr. Jung find you some useful work to do. Okay. So she's assigned as an assistant to Jung, and thus begins her cure, and actually Jung's downfall. She went on, of course, to be very active in establishing psychoanalysis in Leningrad. Came to be, she and her family were killed in the Holocaust. There was a huge effort to find useful work. Whatever it was, if a patient was destructive, they would give them sheets to shred to be used to stuff pillows with. Men would do farming, groundskeeping, animal husbandry, print shop, daguerreotypes, skilled trades, shoe cobbling, harness making, assist the clerk, serve as a librarian. Women would do what women were permitted to do, cooking, cleaning, mending. Somatic treatments were confined, really. They were de-emphasized. They had hot and cold water baths. A diverse armamentarium of laxatives, given the asylum diet, this was probably a mercy. Laudanum, opium, scopolamine, perhaps some Indian hemp. By the 1890s, chlorhydrates, various electrotherapies, fairly harmless variety. Okay. These are some of the devices that would have been used. Afterwards, people would be, well, if you're interested in trying them out, these do function. The whips, the chains, the manacles were all of an earlier era. Although restraint had its way of working its way back in. All the other somatic treatments came well after the 19th century. All right? Insulin shock coma, electroconvulsive therapy, the great lobotomy misadventure, antipsychotics, antidepressants, most sedative hypnotics, most mood stabilizing medications. Those were all the 20th century, not the asylum. The buildings themselves were actually therapeutic. The idea was to control, if you controlled the environment, you would control the mind. It was supposed to work to soothe mental facilities that were made tense by the strain, the noise, the competition, the artificiality of the city. Asylums were magnificent, verdant grounds, architecture that emphasized light, air circulation. Again, they were on to something. Recently, a change in the decor of state hospital inpatient units. This was in Pennsylvania. A change in the decor proved to be more effective in reducing seclusion and restraint than staff training in trauma-centered care or in patient involvement with treatment planning. This was, or changes in unit rules and procedures. This had to do with area rugs, painting the walls warm colors, mood lighting. The idea was to return to sort of bucolic, rural, agrarian, pre-industrial life. They had beautiful grounds designed by the best landscape architectures. This is the Institute for Living. These are the grounds designed by Frederick Law Olmsted, who designed the Chicago Exposition. Frederick Law Olmsted also designed grounds for this institution, arguably containing the most dangerous group of reality you will find concentrated anywhere in this country. They attempted to set these on hills for pleasing vistas. Of course, our own park is a Frederick Law Olmsted design. The interior architecture was ornamented and decorated. The Victorians well knew how to build cheap and ugly. With the asylums, they just chose not to. Victorian culture reveled in the sanctity of the home, the patriarchal nuclear family, as the building block of society. The plans of the asylums in general mirrored their view of society in general. This is the York Retreat. The idea was to produce the ideal home under the benign patriarchal totalitarian guidance of the asylum superintendent. I was the overseer and the example. Superintendents referred to themselves as the father. The asylum was the house. The patients were the family. To this day, the big house is the state psychiatric hospital. Term is used to this day. Okay, this is the York Retreat. It was a Quaker institution set up to practice moral therapy by William Tuke in England. It was the seed of all future asylums. They just grew from this. You can see here's the center wing. Here are the wings, one male, one female. Another wing stepped back for the more violent. In the back, there are the Aryan courts with gardens, rabbits, and chickens to awaken benevolent feelings. Here's the Friends Asylum. Here's a little track out front with a little bicycle thing. The ground for places you would take your family, okay? They were beautiful, visit them. It's the British Country Asylums. It's Hanwell Lunatic Asylum. These were mandated by the 1845 Lunatic Act. 1840 Hanwell here was designed for 500, housed about 1,000. This was the site where Connolly broke up all the restraint chairs here. In the United States, we have the Kirkbride plan here. Here we go. Just go to the state legislature with this as you propose funding for the care of mentally ill. Thomas Stewart Kirkbride was a Quaker. He developed the Kirkbride plan, or the linear plan. And from 1840 to about 1880, asylum construction in the US followed this plan. He lived there along with his family, a male wing and a female wing. The wings are stepped back, one from another. This is designed so you have the best views. Notice the single loaded, which is you have a corridor with rooms only on one side here. That gives a light, airy effect internally. The center main also would hold the chapel, and it would hold the library, the administrative hubs, the recreation halls, the senior staff that lived there as well. Okay. This echelon, here we are. So this was Dorothea Dix's first child, by the way, the first real, you know, Kirkwood Park asylum built in this country. Dorothea Dix was actually to move into this building when she was out. Here's Greystone in Morristown, New Jersey. This was the largest building of its time in the United States. Here's another view from a hot air balloon. There were postcards of these. You can appreciate the size of this thing. Here's the back door, okay? Back doors before the dangerous, the dirty, the violent. It cost $2,500,000 at the time to build. Critics pointed out that at $2,600 per bed, a luxury hotel would only be $1,500 per guest. The equivalent today as a percent of the national gross domestic product for this building would be about $5 billion. Again, propose this to your state legislature. Talk to your senator or congressman about putting that kind of resources in. But they did. It was demolished in October 2015 at the cost of $50 million to tear it down. Oh, here's the Buffalo State Asylum for the insane. Anybody been out to see it?
I work there.
You work there. Beautiful building. What's it being transformed to?
Pardon?
You know what it's being transformed to now?
Buffalo State.
Well, right now the Buffalo State Asylum is going to be opening up as a resort hotel this spring.
Well, the college next door to the State Asylum has eventually taken over some of the building.
Yep.
That's what's going on. Yep. When I was a student, I was not at the state mental hospital, I was at the school visiting the state.
Sorry. There's more to this story here. This is Burtlaw Olmsted grounds there. The whole plan of the thing is rotated off the street grid in order to provide a better southern exposure for the views from inside. There's two women who sort of bracket the asylum. This is Dorothea Dix. She's Unitarian, and in 1841 she visited a local jail in Cambridge, Massachusetts. There she saw mentally ill prisoners chained naked to stone walls in cells without heat or ventilation. And she caught on fire. She began a lifelong crusade to improve the treatment of the mentally ill. In 1843, she informed the Massachusetts legislature of the dreadful conditions. Lunatics chained to walls, shivering cold, dangerous almshouses. She effectively morally coerced legislature after legislature to fund asylums, schools for the feeble-minded, schools for the blind. She traveled to Europe, she traveled to Asia, doing the same thing, exposing barbaric conditions, demanding that governments provide funding. And they did. When she visited the Utica State Asylum, she was distinctly not amused when the literary journal, the Opal, reported a female patient there quipping, "Oh yes, she's a philanthropist, a lover of men, but are we not all lovers of men?" In 1881, as I said, she moved into the New Jersey State Asylum. In Trenton, she lived there for the last 6 years of her life. Nellie Bly. Okay, if you don't know about Nellie, you must. Among other things, she designed a 55-gallon oil drum. So if you like Caribbean music, you owe this to her. But in New York City at the time, if you were wealthy and Madge went to Bloomingdale, if you were poor and Madge went to Bellevue or to the Blackwell Asylum, Blackwell Island Lunatic Asylum. At Blackwell Island, the asylum patients were originally supervised by trustees from the nearby penitentiary. You can imagine how well that worked. In 1887, She got herself a job on the New York World, Joseph Pulitzer's paper. She basically bullied her way in when responding to a misogynistic editorial. So her first assignment was, okay, now you're going to infiltrate the Blackwell Island Asylum. So, oh, first a word for a sponsor. Madame Morris Corsets. I never need breaking in and feel at ease. Any case, yes. 10 Days in a Madhouse. Oh, read it. It's delightful. You'll find it online. Just download the thing. Lecture lost. But the Bluetooth problem has occurred. Oh, my technology. Okay. She practices insanity at home. Got herself mental hygiene arrested. And court committed. Was examined, found to be positively demented, right, and proceeded to report on what she found there at the asylum. She went on to do various great things. In conclusion, I mean, the dream of the asylum was shot through with delusions of its own, okay? It could be a nightmare for some who are caught inside of it, but the Victorians were capable of thinking creatively and optimistically about what their duty was towards those who were deemed incapable of managing their own independence. As believers in the perfectibility of human spirit, they didn't imagine the unfortunate truth that an unchecked hierarchy leads inevitably to abuse. That's just the way people seem to be wired. To this day, the use of mechanical restraints and seclusion has not been completely eliminated. They presumed that a single manner of treatment was appropriate for everyone. They lost sight of the diversity of the conditions and of the people they were dealing with. Humane treatment depends on sufficient time, staff, and leisure. The asylums rapidly became overcrowded and ungovernable. 1806, the average British asylum housed 115. By 1900, it housed over 1,000. With the press of bodies, the enterprise of moral treatment crumbled as well. And by the early 20th century, the asylums had entered the age of despair. Moral treatment is not over. Okay? The elements of it survive in present-day person-centered care. Occupational therapy, vocational therapy, equine, pet therapy, agricultural therapy are all there and all still. The thing is, it's become scattered. It's no longer all available under one roof. And it's become neglected. It's mostly available only in elite private institutions, not to the average patient in a psychiatric hospital. You'll find it at the Institute for Living, Austin Riggs, similar gold-plated places. Today, the severely mentally ill have nearly vanished from public view, except for the occasional hand-wringing following a mass shooting. What's been forgotten is the sense of a shared civic obligation to care for the indigent and sick. Okay. Here we have beds per 100,000, 1850, 1890, the present day. Here's by current standards, the minimum required for adequate care. Here's where we are. This is even putting together all state, all private, all general hospital beds, plus residential treatment centers. You still only get about 39, 40 per 100,000. Well, where are these people now? They're not in the asylums. U.S. prison and jail house an estimated 356,000 inmates in 2012, more than 10 times the number in psychiatric hospitals. The largest inpatient psychiatric facility in this country is the Los Angeles prison system. Instead of fantasizing that we can cure the mentally ill, now we just fantasize that they don't exist. The great public asylums that were constructed during the asylum movement lie in ruins now. Stand on the ground, realize this was a movement that spread over the whole United States, Canada, all of Europe, England, Ireland, Scotland. The modern architectural setting for an impoverished person with a severe mental illness, or schizophrenia, or bipolar disorder, it's not a custom-built asylum, an abandoned subway tunnel, nor a heating grate. Folks we see in rags, talking to hallucinations on the street, barricaded in crumbling, unheated, broken-down buildings without facilities, plumbing. They would have had access to daguerreotype workshops, agricultural settings and training, theater, dances, editorial meetings, golf games, and the custom-built grandeur of a purpose-built asylum. Now, this is the Richardson Olmsted Complex, the old Buffalo Psychiatric Hospital. It is being remodeled on the inside into the Hotel Henry. It's supposed to be in operation next summer. So the center main, the two adjacent wings, are going to be hotel rooms. They were doing tours. You know, look up the website. Here's a few of the books that I have found very useful in researching the period. Drew Yammerin. And questions, or I've also got, as I said, a few devices here if people are interested. Sir?
A couple of comments. The one in your schematic that you had up there, the 1960s was a significant time in New York history.
The
legislature decided that we did not need psychiatric institutions. And in the 3 years I was at the Buffalo State Hospital working, they, little by little, the wings of those hospitals began to be depleted. They would just start emptying them one at a time. And I was watching this transition. The philosophy was that if you give, you know, the advent of pills, if you give this person a pill and discharge them, that everything was going to be okay. Mm-hmm. Obviously, they went home and they threw their pills away. it's ridiculous. I've talked to a couple of psychiatrists about this when I had on occasion. What they said was it was the state of New York. I kind of pointed at them, but they said no, it was the fact that the state wanted to save money.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That was the big thing. Mm-hmm. But the Psychiatric Association wanted this to continue because people need to be housed. What you have on the streets, the homeless people that you see are the ones in 1960s and before would be in places like this, they'd be taken care of. And now they're out on the street, they're under your bridges, and et cetera.
There was an idea of a community mental health movement move away from these huge institutions, but which by this time, these were crumbling, they were often abusive. The idea, well, let's put people in the community, in more like what Guillaume Belgium occurred. The problem is, the money didn't follow. This just did not happen. The money instead went back in the pockets of the taxpayer and now is going out for the jails and prisons. There was also, these asylums were state money. You move people into Medicaid, Medicare, that's federal money. Okay, so that was part of what led to that. Never underestimate the damage that the left wing and the right wing can do when they decide to work together on a problem. It's really been devastating.
Well, Richardson is maybe one of the foremost architects in the mm-hmm. United States.
Yes. And
well, they definitely would not take those buildings down. They were landmark buildings. That they're making them into a hotel is good as long as they don't spoil the architecture.
Well, and that's the whole idea. It's historical preservation. Well, the thing is, the building that's been taken down that I showed you, that's Greystone. And Governor Christie spent $50, $60 million to take it down. Buffalo is spending about the equivalent amount to turn Buffalo Hospital into an urban hotel. These things are pretty bomb-proof. They have walls like this. They're stuffed with asbestos. So it's not necessarily an easy thing to repurpose them, beautiful as they had been. To Buffalo's credit, they're doing something with this building now. And of course, Olmsted was a great landscape.
Oh, he designed Central Park.
Right? Yes, Central Park, the U.S. Capitol grounds.
Highland Park.
Our own Highland Park here.
It's hard when you're in the building.
So only the best was appropriate to give to the mentally ill. Only the best architecture, the best landscape, the best treatment. Sir?
Did that philosophy extend to non-native Americans?
Interestingly, yes. Although, if you take a look at the plan, say, for St. Elizabeth's, there's the building, which is symmetrical, and then there's the colored male and colored female. So it would be that segregation was there. You would intend to house people similarly. Typically, the way these things were constructed, too, you wouldn't have them together, white people. It was that way. Or they would be separate institutions. It was regarded that the mad were mad. And there was less, to be mad was sort of overarching over color. It was worse in its own way. So there certainly was at least that. I certainly was not equal to it. Other questions, comments, observations?
So with mental illness, obviously there's a scale of people being functional in their everyday mm-hmm. lives and people being not functional. People who end up in these places where they just totally not functional, or because some of the descriptions didn't seem that.
Well, there's a gradation of functionality. Remember how these things were constructed with the center main. The ideal highest functioning was the asylum superintendent and his family. The two wards on either side were for people who were really quite functional. Many of the people there would dine with the superintendent if they were proper social status, or they would serve as domestic staff there. As you moved further and further away, you had people who were less and less functioning. The back wards were for the violent, the dirty, the assaulted. By the way, if you were in one of the middle units, you knew that if you acted up, you'd tend to be moved further and further away. So there was that. But the ideal was to rehabilitate people, to restore them to function, give them a trade, a task they could do and accomplish, and get them out so you could go to the county ratepayers and say, I'm curing people. Sir?
One of the problems is that people went in there and sometimes they're committed by their family.
Mm-hmm.
And they, in the case that I'm writing a book about it. A woman was committed by her mother, and she had attempted suicide. Very highly functioning person, but she was kept in that asylum for 65 years.
Mm-hmm.
She died when she was 104.
Well, the story of, Lucy Loved, a transgender who died at Willard.
Well, the fact is that she was kept there, and in her later, later years, when people came in, her cousin came in to see her, she didn't want to be in there. And she was a highly functioning, very intelligent woman who just was not allowed to come out.
Well, this was Nellie Bly's.
So if you've got a problem with that type of thing.
Yeah. This is one observation that Nellie Bly made, that she obviously was not, and said she dropped her act as soon as she reached the shores of Blackwell's Island. So she was obviously not insane, not acting insane, and other of the women there were also clearly not insane. Some, their English wasn't good, they were poor, they were immigrants, they were muddled in other ways. However, there were others who were clearly insane and being mistreated at Blackwell's Island Asylum. So yes, you could be signed in, as happened to Elizabeth Packard. Different states had different laws. Illinois was probably the best in the world because of those Packard's work and advocacy. The economics, though, were set up that the asylum superintendents wanted to demonstrate that they could cure and discharge people. So there was at least that. But yes, there was not a sense of, there was not a mental hygiene legal service at the time. There is now, for just such reasons. Sure.
Could you speak to how combining the old and the new, how we might do better as a mental health system?
Oh, dear. All sorts of ways. Places for people to live would be great. Okay.
Places for people to actually get their medication?
Sorry?
Places for people to actually get their medication?
Well, get their medication or live. It doesn't work for everybody. The medications don't work for everybody. Some of the medications make people feel crummy when they're on it, so they don't take it. But certainly places for people to live has to come first and foremost, where they can be treated in a humane manner, in a jail.